The alleged crash of a UFO on April the 17th, 1897 has been hauled into the focus of the news media again. For new members who may not have read the basic story, we'll recount it briefly again. A Mr. S.E. Hayden, a stringer for newspapers, one who provides local news to big city newspapers, submitted the story to the Dallas Morning News on April the 17th, 1897. In effect, it said that at about 6 a.m., a huge silver-collared cigar-shaped object appeared over the southern horizon, showing two gasoline engines along each side. Both of these engines turned propellers, and another propeller, which bored through the air, was mounted on top, apparently for vertical lift. This is a general description furnished by several people in several areas prior to the Aurora incident. It was estimated that the object was 200 to 300 feet long and 50 feet wide. Seven windows, at least according to the story, were strung along the bottom, and a strung headlight flashed out of the nose. Depending on who was telling this story, it was piloted by one of several persons, some of whom were wearing blue sailor suits. This was the general description of a strange airship, which had been reported throughout the United States that year. However, in the case of the Aurora ship, it was piloted by only one individual, a Martian. Hayden said it came in low over the Aurora town square, zoomed north above Judge J.S. Proctor's house, which was located on a hill, and struck the judge's windmill and exploded. Debris was allegedly scattered far and wide, and when the citizens of Aurora rushed to the site of the wreck, they found the badly disfigured body of the pilot. T.J. Weems, allegedly the U.S. Signal Corps service officer and also an authority on astronomy, made the pronouncement that the pilot came from the planet Mars. Further, the story read, papers were found among the wreckage, but the writing could not be deciphered. According to Hayden, the local citizens cleaned up the debris at noon, gave the pilot a Christian burial at the Aurora Cemetery, which is located on a hill near the town. Mr. Donald Worley, APRO's field investigator at Connersville, Indiana, has submitted the following interesting report. Of a UFO incident which took place on a farm between Gainesville and Millhausen, Decatur County, Indiana, on the morning of March 10, 1972. As usual, Mr. Worley has furnished complete details of a most intriguing UFO report. At a little after 4 a.m. on the 10th, Mr. K.G., name withheld upon request, awoke with a terrible pain in his stomach. It was so severe that when he got out of bed, he then laid down and rolled on the floor. He thought at the time he might be having a heart attack, despite the fact he was only 35, and he wakened his wife, M. The pain began to subside, so he got up and paced the floor. Shortly before, Mr. and Mrs. G spotted a great orange glow beyond the trees to the southeast on Mr. G's father's farm. It lit up the area and seemed to change in intensity. After a while, Mr. G felt well again and went back to bed. However, his wife stayed up and watched the glow for about an hour, after which an orange-colored glowing boomerang-shaped object ascended from the area where the glow was and flew west. When it was south of the G home, it appeared to be about the size of a flying boxcar aircraft and only about 150 feet away from the house. She estimated that the object was about the size of a grapefruit held at arm's length, in other words, very large and very close. It flew at the speed of an ordinary aircraft, she said, and disappeared into the southwest at an elevation of about 45 degrees. Both Mr. and Mrs. G agreed that there had been no wind, no precipitation, no moon, and only one light in the vicinity, a dusk-to-dawn yard light about half a mile from their house. On the next day, Mr. G's father and his son were letting hogs into the field on the elder Mr. G's farm when they found a very strange orange-red, not glowing but very bright, they said, stone. They found it too heavy to carry back to the farm, but did roll it a few feet. The stone was flattish and had purple-colored pits. The following is preliminary information on an incident which took place at dawn on the 22nd of May 1973 between Itajobi and Cataduva. Onilson Papero, who was employed with a firm in Oswaldo Cruz, a district of Ineste do Rio Preto, reported that at dawn on the 22nd of May, he observed a very intense blue light that caused his car to become transparent, interfered with the radio and then the engine of his car, made a noise like a turbine, and attracted him towards as if it were a magnet. It was 3 a.m. when Onilson, who had taken a girl home to Ijobi, was driving to Katanduva on State Route 321, when near kilometer 7, his engine started to fail, and at the same time the radio, which had been working well, began to register a considerable amount of interference. Onilson started to gear his car, an Opala, down from high to second, and then to first gear in an attempt to keep it running. By this time the interior of the car was lit up, giving Papero the feeling that something had gone wrong with the electrical system. Then a beam of light hit him straight in the face, and he had to pull the car to the curb. Some papers were strewn about, but it was later found that nothing was missing. Although there had been two checks among the papers, the men called a patrolman to proceed to the area immediately and succeeded in waking Papero, who became panic-stricken and told his story. The policeman took him to the Pedro Aubino Hospital, where Dr. Elias Aziz Chediak examined him. He was put under observation until 7 p.m. that evening, and nothing unusual was observed, so he went back home to Katanduva. It was noted that Papero's normally brown hair turned completely black on the night of his experience, but has since returned to its normal color. Those basically are the alleged facts. Most UFO researchers are familiar with the airship flap of 1897, when unidentified airships were reported in various states across the country. It's not yet been proved what these things were, indeed if they existed at all. The accounts would be more easily to verify if the descriptions had been more detailed and not tinged with so much emotion. But back to Aurora. Aurora was in pitiful straits in 1896 and 1897. An epidemic of spotted fever had decimated the population, and a lot of people left town because of it. What had been a thriving country town was now a ghost town. S.E. Hayden, a cotton buyer, was in as bad a fix as anyone else. 70 years passed, and the question of the Aurora crash was brought up again by UFO researchers during the furores of the 1966 flap, when the Condom Committee was commissioned to investigate UFO reports and determine whether or not UFOs really existed. Wise Country, where Aurora is located, historians pronounce the whole tale a hoax, but a few believe them. The only qualified scientist to investigate the affair was Dr. Alfred E. Krauss, then director of the Kilgore Research Institute at West Texas State University. He made two visits to Aurora, during which he carried out a careful investigation. On his second trip, he used a metal detector to search the supposed crash site, but turned up nothing of interest. What he found, he said, were old stove lids, rings used on horse bridles, and some 1932 license plates, but nothing which could be interpreted as having been part of a flying silver cigar. Dr. Krauss also interviewed people who'd lived in Aurora at the time, and they denied any knowledge of a crash. One, Oscar Lowry of Newark, was a resident of Aurora and 11 years old at the time. He had been visited by no less than a dozen newspaper and magazine reporters, one of whom offered him a large sum of money to verify the crash story. Around the middle of April, a UFO buff, who has a reputation as a gadfly, who flits hither and yon as circumstances allow, when a Midwest area is infected with UFO reports, brought up the Aurora case again. He apparently had not done any research to speak of, because he was not aware of the basic history involved. As this individual began to get attention from the news media, others jumped on the bandwagon and the controversy flared anew. This new crew of Aurora investigators included a newspaper reporter who showed up at the little town wearing a jacket emblazoned with the NASA, National Aeronautics and Space Administration, emblem, and leaving the impression that he was a representative of NASA. He made no attempt to identify himself as other than that either, but he produced bits of fused metal resembling aluminium, which he claimed he retrieved from the crash site. During a telephone interview with Mrs. Lorenzen, the bulletin's editor, he said that immediately upon finding the metal, he had sent it out of the country to be analyzed because he was afraid that government authorities might confiscate it. Daily newspaper articles in Dallas papers said that the metal had been sent to a government research laboratory in Canada and another sample to a scientist in this country. But the reporter and his cohorts refused to identify the latter, because Dr. J. Allen Hynek was mentioned prominently in news articles as planning to visit Aurora to investigate the findings. Mrs. Lorenzen put in a call to him and asked if he had any knowledge of Dr. Krause's investigation, to which he replied that he did not. She also pointed out that Krause's investigation in 1967 had yielded no mysterious metal. Dr. Hynek then informed her that he knew the name of the scientist who had examined the mysterious metal and that the man was legitimate. She asked him if the metal was unusual. It was a fairly common aluminium alloy, he said, referring back to the file of the 1897 crash, including recent clippings from Dallas papers. The APRO staff also noted that while quite a bit of very mundane metal was found by the current investigation, the new metal was found to be an aluminium alloy, which could not have been manufactured on Earth before 1908, but later. While the mundane metal, iron, was badly rusted, the aluminium alloy, according to the unnamed scientists, was in good condition. A check with members of the consulting staff of APRO yielded some interesting information concerning this turn of events. Aluminium alloy, manufactured prior to World War II, contained copper and had been buried for such a long period it would have been badly corroded. Alloys developed and manufactured during and since World War II are much hardier and would stand up under the elements much better.